All right, this is David Arvelo with the Doombeard Report here. I'm speaking with current Matrix Fight promoter and former Bellator matchmaker Sam Caplan. How you doing, man?
It's good to speak with you, David.
So I wanted to touch base. You know, like I had mentioned to you before, I'm unfortunately going to have to miss the upcoming Matrix Fights event because I'll be at my rehearsal dinner. But
I think that's a legitimate excuse. I think you can get by with that one.
Yeah, yeah. You know, like I said before, it's very rare that you know, other things in my life will preclude me from you know, watching or going to MMA events that I kind of had my heart set on going to. But you know, my woman kind of put her foot down on that one.
I can understand why.
But so the upcoming Matrix Fights event, Matrix Fights 9, it's December 5th in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania at the Pennsylvania National Guard Armory. Give us your thoughts on, you know, both the main event and, you know, some of the other great fights that you have lined up on that card, man.
You know, the one thing that I've learned in this business, David, is that the most important thing when you do an MMA promotion, above anything else, are the fighters and the fights that you put on. You can talk all you want about production and this and that and all the bells and whistles, but it all comes back down to the fights and the fighters. And I think that there's a lot of record building going on the regional and local MMA level, which, you know, it's great for the friends and family of that specific fighter. But I'm excited that Matrix Fights is back and doing this with my partners, Jimmy Binns Jr. and Phil and Ricardo McLaurice of Balance Studios here in Philadelphia. We're getting back to creating an event level show. We don't want to do shows just because we have, you know, a contract with a venue or a casino, or, you know, we have multi-fight agreements with all our fighters, and we got to do shows to keep everybody busy and keep everybody happy. We want to do events. We want it to be an organic reason why this show is coming together, why it's happening. And we were, you know, able to put together a big fight between two guys in Levon Maynard and Jesus Martinez, two guys that I've worked with very much on the national and also regional level. And there was an opportunity to bring these guys together, have them go head to head. And, you know, for a regional matchup, I think that's a really strong fight. It's a fight that, you know, leaves the question, who's going to win? You see a lot of matchups now, and you pretty much know what the outcome of that fight is going to be. Unless somebody slips on the banana peel and an accident happens in the cage, you pretty much know what the outcome is going to be. It's easy to anticipate. With this fight now, Levon Maynard, Jesus Martinez, it's split down the middle. It's leaving a lot of people wondering what's going to be the outcome of this fight. There's going to be a lot of drama and there's going to be a lot of intrigue, and I'm very excited about that. We're also very excited to get the permission of Bellator MMA, you know, an organization that I used to work for and I have still a great relationship with, the ability to work with them, you know, and get Will Martinez, who's a semifinalist in the Bellator featherweight tournament last year, to get him you know, an opportunity to come back in front of his hometown fans in Philadelphia and fight on a Matrix Fights show. You know, you've seen him on the big show. You've seen him on Spike TV. Now you get to see him in a more intimate environment. Will has a school 10 minutes away from the armory in Philadelphia. So it's going to be very exciting for his friends, family, and, of course, all of his students. And then we have the big one, the mixed martial arts debut of Powell Wolak. Powell Wolak, a former boxing champion, has been training MMA for the last couple of years in North Jersey with all the Henzo Gracie guys. Mm. And to have him make his professional MMA debut on our show, it's very exciting because that's a guy who I believe you're going to see on bigger shows in the next couple of years. You're going to see him on a Bellator or a UFC, because the industry right now, the sport, needs a guy like that. It needs someone that's very unique and has a different skill set and, you know, that's coming to the forefront here that's going to, you know, the guy that has something different that's going to separate himself from everyone else that's currently competing in the sport.
Right on. You know, I think, you know, when I saw that matchup, I had previously seen an article where Illinois had denied Pablo Wolak a license to compete as a professional mixed martial arts fighter, and they wanted him to have amateur fights. And his coaches, you know, kind of asked a very important question, you know, who the hell as an amateur is going to fight that guy? As a, you know, in a mixed martial arts fight. So I was very glad to see that, you know, common sense prevailed in Pennsylvania.
And David, sorry to cut you off, but it was an interesting process because when we presented it to Greg Serb, Greg was a little uncomfortable with it because, you know, the rule here in PA is you have to have three amateur wins, three official sanctioned wins as an amateur before you can turn pro. Mm-hmm. And obviously Powell doesn't have that. And I think Greg was a little concerned about the precedent that he might set. You know, is it going to allow all these other guys that don't have three wins to come in and kind of demand the ability to be licensed as a pro. And what we explained to Greg was, well, you're setting a real strong precedence here in that, you know, if they come to you and say, well, if you're a world champion in boxing, yes, I will consider licensing you pro right away. And, you know, Greg also, you know, mentioned to us, hey, what about the idea of him doing an amateur fight? Can we talk about that? And I said, Greg, you know, I'm not comfortable putting someone's life, you know, in danger like that. I'm not going to have a world champion boxer fight an amateur MMA athlete. There's no way I would ever do that as a promoter and a matchmaker. It just, you know, I don't think that's particularly fair. I think anyone that can give Powell Wolak like a challenge is probably already licensed as a pro. There's not going to be many guys on the amateur level that can hang with a guy like Powell Wolak. Because you have to understand, he not only has world-class hands, David, he also wrestled in high school, and he's been training with the guys at Henzo Gracie for the last 2 years. He's been getting some of the best instruction on the ground that you could get. And so he's been doing it for 2 years. It's not like he just started doing this a month ago. He's really been preparing a long time for this debut. So, you know, I personally was not comfortable putting him in there as an amateur. And I think it's crazy that, you know, I respect the Illinois Commission, but with all due respect, I think it's crazy that they would be open to the idea of having a world champion boxer fight, you know, an amateur mixed martial artist.
Yeah, I agree. Like, I just read that, and I just, you know, I wondered if, you know, as a matchmaker myself, I was just like, I was thinking, A, you know, who would be as an amateur fighter, who would be crazy enough to do that? You know, and then B, like, that's just not something that I don't think, you know, anyone could do in good conscience. But yeah, I guess, you know, you guys have you guys found an opponent for him yet?
There's been some issues with the opponent, but we're talking to someone now and we're in final negotiations, and I think we're going to have it wrapped up pretty soon.
Cool. Yeah, I think it'll be I'll be interested to see who he ends up fighting. You know, I think you know, just kind of you know, like when Tyrone Spong made his MMA debut, you know, you'll get a lot of people who will, you know, kind of automatically think that his opponent will just try to take him down. But you know, I think with him training with you know, the different guys from all the different Henzo Gracie gyms and stuff, I think you know, he'll be, you know, pretty well prepared for that.
Yeah, and I think early on, at least for this fight December 5th, we're looking for striking-based guys. The options that we have there are all striking-based guys. And the reason for that is because, you know, Powell Wolak, it's his first fight in MMA. He hasn't had any amateur fights. He hasn't had any pro fights. So it's you know, definitely reasonable to come in here and say, hey, we're not going to put him in there with a wrestler right away. And I think the fans that are going to be buying tickets to see him, they don't want to see him. They don't want to see Powell Wolak, who has world-class hands. They don't want to see him in a wrestling match. They want to see him strike. And we've got some guys that are definitely willing to do that. They have that striking-based background. Not a lot of – like Powell, they don't have a lot of refined experience on the ground. So, you know, we want to match him up with a striking-based guy, and I think we're going to be able to do that here pretty soon.
Awesome. And what weight class will he be competing in MMA?
It will be a 160-pound catchweight for his first fight December 5th, but I think his – regular weight class will be 155 pounds. Once he's done the cut a couple times, you'll see him settle into that lightweight division.
Awesome. I mean, I think, you know, again, even on the regional scene, kind of like you said before, I think that he really, you know, injects something new and different into the 155-pound weight class. It's rare to get, you know, you get national champion wrestlers and world champion grapplers all the time. But to get a guy with his boxing credentials and mixed martial arts, especially you know, when he's had the type of training, you know, on the ground that he's been doing the past couple of years, I think he's going to do well, personally. What about you?
I think he's going to do really well. You know, I said it on Twitter. I think that the camp that he chose to make the transition with, Henzo Gracie, you know, I don't think he could have picked a better camp out there. There's, you know, a lot of good camps out there. You know, the guys in Alliance in San Diego, the guys in American Top Team down in Florida. You have, you know, Greg Jackson's, you know, in New Mexico. So there's a lot of good camps all over the country, but Powell is a New York, New Jersey-based guy, and that is, you know, the camp for him to work with there. You're not going to find a better, more qualified guy in the New York, New Jersey area when it comes to Brazilian jiu-jitsu instruction than Henzo Gracie. It's just not possible.
Cool. And I guess if you don't mind, you mind giving me a brief history on Matrix fights and your involvement with them?
Well, Matrix started, you know, I would say, I think we're going on our fifth year, and I started out as the matchmaker. You know, it was the second ever promotion that I had matchmade for, and it was a dream come true to be able to matchmake you know, in my hometown of Philadelphia in a very historic venue at the time. It was the ECW Arena. So to be able to do a show there was a lot of fun. But the founders of the promotion, and they're still involved with it to this day, are Jimmy Binns Jr., as well as the Miglarice brothers, Phil and Ricardo Miglarice. And Phil and Rick have a successful school here in Philadelphia called Balance Studio with Balance Studios with affiliates all over the country and all over the world even. And they are Helson Gracie black belts. So to be able to work with guys like that is just tremendous. And, you know, Jimmy Binns is a good friend of mine. I used to work for a small promotion here on the East Coast called Combat in the Cage. And it was a very interesting time. You know, they were doing a lot of shows in Delaware before it was regulated, and they did some shows in New Jersey. But they were one of the forerunners here in the tri-state area when you talk about PA, New York, New Jersey, when it comes to MMA and fight promotions here in this area. And the gentleman that was the promoter there was Ed Sue, and he brought Jimmy Binns in as a partner. This was about 2006, 2007. And, you know, Ed was a guy that a lot of people had trouble working with. Jimmy and I both had issues with him on a separate level. But, you know, I made a good friend in Jimmy, and Jimmy told me that, you know, even though his experience as a part owner of an MMA promotion with Ed Sue wasn't really favorable, wasn't, you know, something that he was excited about, he was still going to look to get back into MMA with a promotion of his own. And he told me, you know, true to his word, he said that once he starts that promotion, I would be his matchmaker. And 2 years later, in 2009, he brought me in, and I was given that opportunity. So it was an honor then to work with Jimmy, Phil, and Rick as a matchmaker, and it's an even bigger honor now that they would think enough of me after Bellator to bring me in as a part owner and also give me the opportunity to kind of be out front and get a promoter's license with them and promote these shows for them.
Right on. I guess, you know, you're having this event December 5th. You know, what does the future of Matrix Fights in 2015 and beyond, what does that look like, man?
Well, you know, you asked about the history of Matrix, and, you know, we can talk about the future, but if you look at our history, that's kind of pretty much what our future is going to be. You look at some of the guys that have fought for us over the years. You look at a Will Martinez, who went on to Bellator and fought in a $100,000 featherweight tournament. You look at Sammy Oropeza, who just had a big win last week on the Bellator undercard against Gary Tapasua. Sammy O has fought several times and headlined several Matrix fight shows over the year. Cole Conrad fought his second pro MMA fight. I had actually was kind of in that that was a transitional time for me. I was a consultant for Bellator, and I made the first ever Matrix fights. Mm-hmm. And I scouted Cole Conrad, went up to his training camp in Minneapolis at Minnesota Mixed Martial Arts with Greg Nelson, scouted him. I signed him to a contract before he ever had a pro fight. The plan was, before Bellator was going to start officially doing shows, to get Cole some fights and build up his record. He did his first fight on a small show. I believe it was either in South Dakota or Western Minnesota. And, you know, he got that win there. And then I brought him to Bellator while he was still under contract. I brought him to Matrix while he was still under contract to Bellator. And we got him that second win. And it was really exciting to have a guy like that, a former NCAA champion, who, you know, would go on to be a Bellator heavyweight champion, to have him have his second ever fight in Bellator was just, I mean, in Matrix was just tremendous. Wilson Hayes, who just won on the UFC last week on the undercard against Scott Jurgensen down in Brazil. He's a Matrix veteran, has two wins under the Matrix banner. His last fight before the UFC was in Matrix. Popo Bezeja is another fighter that you saw in Bellator. So what I'm trying to make here, the point is, Matrix has a history of bringing in top talent from the East Coast and projecting that talent onto a higher level. We've created a very big stage. We've done some great events, and we're looking to get back to that. You know, like I said, we're not looking to do shows. We're looking to do events. We're only going to do about 2 to 3 events a year. We're not going to do monthly shows or you know, bi-monthly shows. We're just going to do a couple events a year, make them big events, the kind of events that everyone talks about, and we're going to put on guys like LaVon Maynard, like Jesus Martinez and Will Martinez, as well as the next guys that are going to follow in their footsteps and fight on the bigger shows. You're going to see the next Wilson Hayes and the Sammy Oropeza. You're going to see all of that in 2015, and we're all very excited about that here at Matrix.
Awesome. You know, you touched on Cole Conrad. He was a guy who, you know, always was a real intriguing fighter, you know, just coming in with his kind of credentials. I mean, in Bellator, he pretty much just ran the tables on everyone he faced. And then he, you know, kind of, retired, you know, well, you know, while he's still definitely in his prime. You know, what are your thoughts on, you know, what caused him to do that?
It's definitely, I believe, the fault of Bellator. We did not do a good job of promoting Cole. We did not get him enough fights. We did not keep him active enough. And Cole wanted to get married, wanted to start a family. and just felt that the income he was making in MMA and the lack of job stability, it just wasn't the direction he wanted to go in for him starting a family. So he got a good job there in the Minneapolis area and felt like it was going to be more security and more stable, and it was going to be a better way for him to take care of his family. The problem was, I think, with Cole that Bellator had was that his initial fights were not very exciting. He was a little one-dimensional, which is to be expected when a world champion wrestler crosses over to MMA. It takes them time to get comfortable and to develop new skills. And in the interim, they're going to rely on the skill that has made them a world champion in the past. They're going to wrestle, and they're going to use that skill. And I think Cole's wrestling and his athleticism was just so good. He got to the title position in Bellator too soon. He was so good. You know, he was able to win a title before he could really develop his skills. And once he won that title, it put us in a position where he had to headline any show that he was on, and we had to put him on TV. Whereas if he hadn't advanced as quickly as he had through the Bellator heavyweight rankings, we could have kept him on the undercards a little bit longer, got him a little more comfortable, got him to a point where we felt he was a more finished product, and put ourselves in a position where we didn't have any reservations about putting him on TV and putting him in big main events. But he, you know, some of these wrestlers, they're too good too soon for their own good.
Yeah, I think Ben Askren might be another great example of that. He pretty much came into Bellator, and no one really came close even to having an answer for him.
Maybe Jay Haran, maybe. You know, that was a very close fight, but, I still felt that Ben won that fight.
Yeah, I think, it would have been interesting. I mean, the welterweight tournament where Ben Saunders and Douglas Lima had their rematch, I had trained with Ben Saunders before that fight, and, he had talked about how, if he could get through and face Ben Askren, that between, rubber guard and, elbows being allowed in a championship bout, that, he kind of thought he finally had the answer to Ben Askren just constantly grounding people. What do you think of that fight had ever happened, man?
I respect Ben Saunders a lot. He's one of my favorite fighters to watch and really enjoyed working with him. But I don't think he would have had an answer for Ben Askren. I don't think there's really anyone in the world right now at 170 pounds that has an answer for Ben Askren. I think the only thing that you can hope for is maybe to get lucky and somehow stuff a takedown and try to hit him with a big shot and knock him out. I don't see a jiu-jitsu guy being able to submit him. I've watched, Marcelo Garcia in New York, would have I don't know if he still has it, but he used to have a webcam in his gym, and you could go to his website and just pull that up any time of day, and you could see who was training in there. And I remember it when I was training at Dada's Fight Camps, one of the guys there pulled up live video of Ben Askren rolling with Marcelo Garcia, and Marcelo definitely got the better of him, but, Ben Askren was giving him, a pretty strong run there. And it was very difficult for Marcelo to get some of those submissions. And Marcelo is one of the best in the world when it comes to sport jiu-jitsu. I just feel like, if you look at Ben, not only is he a former NCAA champion wrestler, one of the best amateur wrestlers we've ever had in the United States and possibly even in the world, you look at his wrestling, but he also is a strong, strong grappler. Positionally, once he gets to the ground, once he takes you down and put you on the ground, positionally, he's so strong and so fluid and so unorthodox on the ground, the way he moves from position to position. He's one of the few guys that you'll see that can make fundamental mistakes in that he puts himself in a bad position, and he's able to overcompensate that. He'll do that. He'll do things that you're taught not to do. He'll do it so that someone will open up and maybe try to go for something positionally that he can counter and get an even more dominant position. So he's one of the few guys you will see that's such a good grappler that he can take one step back in order to put himself in a position on the ground where he can take two steps forward. I believe by now he's probably a brown belt in Brazilian jiu-jitsu, and with his tendon strength, he's not a guy that I could ever imagine being tapped out in an MMA fight. I just don't see it happening.
Right on. You guys are, really looking to, even with just a couple events a year, really kind of inject some new blood into, the MMA scene in Philadelphia. In the region, you pretty much have what are largely smaller MMA shows. In Pennsylvania, and then, CFFC and Ring of Combat have been doing their thing in New Jersey largely. What is the state of especially the professional mixed martial arts scene in Pennsylvania and Philadelphia, and have fighters had enough of a chance to be active?
I think this market, if anything, would be oversaturated. There's so many shows in PA and New Jersey on a weekly basis. You know, we're doing a show December 5th. There's another promotion doing a show the same night, about 40 minutes away. They're not going to have as strong of a fight card as we're going to have, but it just goes to show you just how many promoters are here out in this area. It's a battle to get dates and get venues. There was a recent lawsuit in PA. One promoter was suing another because they felt that they created a monopoly in this area and they had all the casino venues. And I'm not sure about the merits of that case. You know, I'd have to look and, you know, read the document, but it just goes to show you just how populated this area is on the East Coast with shows and how many promoters are all competing for the same territory. It's kind of, it's very interesting, and it's a very, unique time for MMA in the PA, New Jersey area. I think it'll be alleviated somewhat when New York opens up because there'll be more venues, more casinos, you know, and there'll be more fighters. And I think a lot of the New York guys will fight New York, but it'll also be an option for maybe some of the Northern Jersey guys to do that. So it's going to be interesting to see how things progress in 2015, but it's very competitive in this area when it comes to the mixed martial arts market.
What are your thoughts on, when MMA might get legalized in New York? It's been a, you know, long time, need really for, the scene up there. There's a ton of great gyms in New York, but right now the closest thing to mixed martial arts you have is really a sham of unregulated amateur mixed martial arts where guys aren't getting blood tested. And I remember Nick Lembo, he was recently interviewed and said that he's turned down quite a few fighters attempting to go pro coming out of New York who have fought, and some even continue to fight as amateurs in New York, who have failed blood tests on their applications.
Well, we shouldn't say all the shows in New York are unregulated. I think the law in New York, as it reads, is that you are allowed to do amateur mixed martial arts if you have a sanctioning body. And I know that organizations like the WKA are sanctioning some of these shows in New York, but some of these promotions, they don't want to pay the fees, and they're just kind of eschewing the WKA and some of the other sanctioning bodies out there, and they're just doing – they're going rogue and they're doing shows on their own, which isn't right. It isn't good for the sport. And if something were to happen on one of those shows, God forbid, you know, it would not only, you know, result in the potential loss of life or a serious bodily injury, but it would definitely greatly set back any gains that MMA has made in the New York Congress there. And it's just sad, though, that the real reason why we don't have MMA completely legalized in New York has nothing to do with the merits of the sport. It has to do with a union issue that goes back to the Fertittas and their casinos in Las Vegas. Yeah. And, you know, you unions have a lot of control, and they don't feel like they've been given a fair shake by the Fertittas, which have, you know, non-union casinos over there. And a lot of these politicians, they rely on the unions for you know, support through votes and through, campaign contributions. And they're not willing to go against the unions and vote to legalize the sport of MMA. I would really love to see the Fertittas, instead of spending so much money on, you know, these lobbyists and these lobby firms, to try to reach out directly to the unions and try to work something out that is a win-win for everyone, because it would bring a lot of tax revenue and fees to the state of New York, and it would also give, you know, the Fertittas and Zuffa the ability to start doing big shows in New York and increase their bottom line. And of course, it'd be great for all the gyms and all the other promoters on a smaller level. A promotion like Matrix Fights would love to go out into the New York market and do shows maybe on Long Island or Manhattan or upstate New York with some of the casinos there. It stinks to see a very tricky political issue impede the progress of a lot of mixed martial arts promotions in the New York area and surrounding areas, for that matter.
Agreed. If you don't mind, I know that, right now you're a promoter for Matrix Fights, and, previously you were the, longtime, matchmaker for Bellator Fighting Championships. Do you mind just giving us your overall MMA background?
Well, I first started, in 93 as a fan. I was a huge pro wrestling and boxing fan, and as a pro wrestling fan, I became a subscriber to the Wrestling Observer newsletter that Dave Meltzer has written so well for all these years, and it's kind of become the Wall Street Journal of the fight industry. And But, you know, back then reading it, you know, I'd read it for the pro wrestling, but then there, I started reading about this concept, new concept on pay-per-view that he was very excited about. Wrote about it, you know, started writing about it a couple months in advance. And it was basically the Super Bowl of martial arts, where it was going to take different martial arts styles and put them against one another and determine once and for all what was the truly dominant martial arts style. And, you know, as a teenager, that was right up my alley because, you know, everyone would always have those discussions. Well, you know, karate's better than judo, and, you know, a boxer would knock anyone out. Or, no, a kickboxer would definitely cut the legs out of a boxer, and kickboxing is the best style to have. So to me, even though it really wasn't truly what it was billed as, it's still on the surface being a 15-year-old, 16-year-old, that was what I thought it was going to be, exactly that, the Super Bowl of martial arts, and it was going to determine what the most dominant, most lethal style of martial arts was going to be. And watching that show, coming from a pro wrestling orientation, seeing Hoist Gracie, you know, just choke out guys much bigger than him, guys that were muscular and guys that looked the part of a pro wrestler, seeing that and not understanding jiu-jitsu fully for what it was at the time, you know, I'm like, oh, this is fixed. You know, I was a kid, I was 15 or 16. I was just like, there's no way in real life this guy would choke these guys out. But, you know, by Hoist Gracie bringing jiu-jitsu to the forefront in the United States, it started to educate ignorant people like myself, and we started to learn more and more about jiu-jitsu, and we started to realize just how great of a martial arts style it was, and how it was basically invented to give a smaller person the ability to level the playing field against someone that may be bigger and stronger by taking them off their feet, putting them on their back, and using some high level technique that the bigger person might not have been well versed in. So we all learned the power of jiu-jitsu, in 1993, and I continued to follow the sport off and on. It was very tough to keep up with MMA before 2001 because it was such a renegade sport. It was, you know, no holds barred at the time, as it was known, I guess, between 93 and 2001, and sometimes you could get access to it and other times you couldn't. But, you know, growing up, you know, as a fan of martial arts and especially a fan of Bruce Lee, in 2001, I started training Kung Fu here at a local martial arts studio. And over time, you know, I started to transition to MMA because, you know, I was also a bouncer on the side. You know, I did that to try to make some extra money. And a lot of the guys that I worked with, you know, we all had some kind of martial arts training. A lot of the guys that I was working with, they had left traditional martial arts like Kung Fu or karate and had migrated to MMA. And even though I had been watching it for years, it really never occurred to me to start training it. But I was always told that it was a more practical form of self-defense, and that as a bouncer and someone working in security, I really needed to switch over and try it. And eventually I did, and I became hooked right away, and, you know, wanted to start competing even before I was really technically supposed to. I was coming a year off of spinal cord surgery, and, you know, you had to have a certain amount of months training in order to compete at the Smokers at the gym I was training at, which was Dadis Fight Camps in Philadelphia. And I was participating in Smokers in about 2003, 2005, before MMA was even legal in the state of Pennsylvania. So I kind of did that, and that kind of was my introduction into mixed martial arts. You know, the first thing I did before anything else was I watched it, and then I participated in it before I ever wrote an article about it or made a matchup. You know, that was my exposure to it. And for me, I had to look for other ways to be a part of MMA because it became apparent very quickly that I was not going to have a future as a full-time fighter in mixed martial arts. Just the level of athleticism and skill was far above what I had, you know, potentially as a fighter. So, you know, I was looking for other ways to stay in the sport, and kind of got involved in journalism because that was my background at the time. But, you know, even doing that, I was looking for even bigger ways to get involved, and I was doing all kinds of things. And eventually I kind of transitioned over to, matchmaking, which is, you know, really how I've made a name for myself in this sport and really my bread and butter and what I do predominantly right now.
Right on. You know, you've mentioned before that you've worked for, other mixed martial arts companies besides Matrix and Bellator. Do you, care to comment on that, man?
Yeah, you know, I've worked for a lot of companies. I mentioned Combat in the Cage. I was basically an intern for them. I paid my dues with them. I was setting up cages and chairs and doing a lot of operational stuff free of charge. It was a way for me to learn more about the business and the industry from the inside out as opposed to the outside in. I was able to work for M1 Global. I had the opportunity to, you know, work with closely with Fedor Emelianenko for a year and working with the Russians and the Dutch over there, and helping them with the M1 Challenge, and then also with some of the pay-per-views they did with Affliction. Met a good friend of mine now by the name of Joe Kelly, who was working for M1 at the time. He was their director of operations, and Joe had his own promotion here back in the States called Titan Fighting, which he had run for several years out of the Great Memorial Hall in Kansas City. So after Joe and I both left M1, it was just a natural progression for me to get involved with Titan, and I was able to work for Titan and Matrix at the same time. So worked for a lot of different organizations. Had the honor to work with Showtime and CBS as a part of their production team. Kind of a guy, is sort of behind the curtain a little bit, and had the opportunity to be part of the first ever mixed martial arts event televised live on primetime network TV. That was in Newark, New Jersey. The fight between Kimbo Slice and James Thompson. I was on that crew and was able to work that show, and it was a tremendous honor to get that opportunity. So I've been very blessed. I've been able to work with a lot of different organizations, and all of them well-run organizations for the most part, with maybe the exception of M1, but able to work with a lot of classy people, and I've been fortunate that I've had a lot of great opportunities in this industry.
Yeah, I remember the James Thompson Kimbo Slice fight. I was in college, and I was the first person out of really everyone I knew at the college I was attending who really got into it. And I had a bunch of friends over at my place, and I turned it on, and a lot of people, they recognized Kimbo, of course. From YouTube fame, but I remembered watching that fight, and Kimbo's subsequent fights for that organization, and it really was a he kind of rode like a big wave of success until he fought Seth Petruzzelli. It was a pretty interesting time up until he got finished by Seth pretty quickly, and then some of the accusations started getting thrown around after that.
And I had the opportunity to work behind the scenes for that show, so I was kind of at the epicenter. And Kimbo was supposed to fight Ken Shamrock, and everyone knew what Kimbo's limitations were, and no one really cared, because Kimbo was what he was, and he wasn't trying to be anything more than that. And he was a guy that was very young to MMA, and was a guy that had some ability with his hands, and a powerful puncher. But as a well-rounded mixed martial artist, he really wasn't that at that time. So the idea was to match him in a way that was fair to him as in his early progression as a mixed martial arts athlete. They kind of developed him the same way they would with anyone that had no fights or one fights or a couple fights into their career. So they wanted to develop him slowly and give him the right matchups. And Ken Shamrock was the guy that was earmarked for that fight, but there were some issues backstage prior to the fight. Especially the day before, Ken Shamrock got wind of what Kimbo was making, and it was more than what Ken was scheduled to fight. And from what I've been told, Ken believed, and his attorneys believed, that he had what's known as a favored nations clause with EliteXC, which stipulated that he had to make, no matter what he was at, he would always have to be the highest paid athlete in EliteXC. And if they signed someone that was making more than him, that they would have to redo his contract and bring him up to that level. Well, I don't think that CBS and EliteXC felt the same way. And, when Ken found out what Kimbo was going to make, he made demands, last-minute demands. He wanted to have his bout agreement changed and wanted to be paid more, and he was turned down. And sure enough, the morning of the fight, he claimed that he was rolling with a training partner and that he suffered a cut. And he showed up to the arena, went right to the commission. The commission took a look at him, and they said there was no fight. So it put Seth Petruzzelli in a weird position, and I haven't really talked about this yet, but I had a hand in making that matchup. If you look back, if you ask me the question, what was the first match that I made in MMA? It was probably Seth Petruzzelli versus Kimbo Slice, because we were doing a rehearsal when we got word that Ken was out, and we were called backstage and told that we were all on headset, and we were told we had to go backstage at once. And they didn't tell us why. They wouldn't tell us what the reason was over the headset. So we thought maybe there was some kind of tragedy. Someone had died in the morning, or somebody from the crew had gotten into a car accident. We were speculating in our walk back from the cage to backstage what was going on, because it was very unusual to stop a rehearsal right in the middle. So we knew something bad had happened. And we got back there, and we were told by the staff at CBS and Showtime exactly what was going on. And it was interesting, because no one from EliteXC was really in the building at that time. And at that point, CBS and Showtime had given EliteXC so much money through loans in order to keep the company going that they were the ones really calling the shots at that point. Mm-hmm. So we were all brought into a room, and they were discussing the options. They were discussing the canceling that show, or possibly moving Roy Nelson and Andre Arlovsky, who were on that show, to the main event. They were talking about, you know, can we find a replacement for Kimbo? Can we get Frank Shamrock to fight, step in and fight Kimbo? And, you know, all those options were brought up, and a lot of them were not feasible. So we came back to, is there someone else we could get to fight Kimbo and keep this show together without canceling it? And, you know, somebody raised the question, is there anyone on the undercard? And I looked at the undercard, and I mentioned the name Seth Petruzzelli. I go, Seth is fighting, because there were no heavyweights on the card.
Yeah.
But I said that Seth is a 205er who has fought for, at heavyweight, and I go, and he has competed on the Ultimate Fighter. He's got some exposure. Some people might know him. And there were two CBS executives, Jody Roth and Jack Sussman, who really weren't fight people. They were high-level CBS executives. Jack Sussman was I don't know if he's still there, but at the time, he was the head of all the live events. You know, if CBS did the Grammys or anything like that, Jack Sussman was the in-house producer for CBS of broadcasts like that. So I mentioned Seth Petruzzelli, and as soon as I said The Ultimate Fighter, Jody Roth and Jack Sussman, immediately they jumped up and they said, what? You know, they started asking me a lot of questions about Seth, and then I was asked the question, what do you think will happen? I said Seth is going to win the fight. I thought that Seth would take Kimbo down and submit him within a couple minutes, and I said, that's the likely scenario. And Jack Sussman's response was, well, if we can't keep Kimbo on the show, I have to cancel it, and I'm going to put on a CSI rerun because that'll get a higher rating than anything else we could headline with. You know, he goes, Roy Nelson, Andre Arlovsky, we're not going to headline with that. A CSI rerun will get better ratings than that. So, you know, he said, and he looked and said to everyone, we all knew that this day was going to happen, that Kimbo probably was going to lose because, you know, he's not, you know, he's limited in as a mixed martial artist. We knew this day was going to happen. It's going to happen a lot sooner. We're going to have to put him in pretty deep water in order to save the show. And, you know, no one was really surprised by the outcome. I think maybe they were surprised that Kimbo got knocked out. But from the people that I talked to, Kimbo really did not have a strong camp going into that fight and really didn't spar a lot. So he wasn't really conditioned and immune to taking shots to the head. And once he got that kick to the head, he went down pretty easy. And it was an easy fight for Seth Petruzzelli to win. But yeah, getting back to your question, and I don't even know if you posed the question. I think I went off on a tangent here, but that was the first fight in MMA that I ever made. And I destroyed an entire company.
Yeah. You know, that's great though. That was some great stuff. You know, I was just sitting here, just kind of listening to what you were saying. Just like, wow, you know, it was nice to get that behind the scenes perspective on that. You know, kind of circling back to something that you had mentioned before. At the regional level, I think we've all seen it. You know, the padding of records, and you know, also referred to as can crushing. You know, just, you know, some of these guys making their way up, you know, they have, you know, these stellar records, and then you look at the quality of competition. And a recent example is this guy, Deshaun Johnson. He got into the UFC. I believe he's a 55er. He actually has some decent boxing credentials, but he fought all of his professional fights for this promotion in California called Explode Fight Series. They've made a name for themselves for basically being, you know, kind of a real shit show, you know, putting, you know, undefeated studs up against guys with zero wins. And, you know, this guy basically fought winless opponents except for one guy. He fought the same guy twice who actually had a couple wins. He went into the UFC at 9-0. He's dropped two straight. They'll probably feed him to someone else before he gets cut. But
well, Deshaun Johnson's actually already been cut.
Oh, he was. Oh, okay. Yeah,
yep. I guess he's no longer. That. Yeah, he's no longer on the UFC roster.
Well, that makes sense. I mean, he seemed completely over his head in both the fights of his that I saw. As a former matchmaker for a very large organization, you know, what are your thoughts and how did you weigh, you know, records versus quality of competition?
Well, you know, you don't see sabermetrics used very much in MMA, but there are some numbers that you can use. And, you know, it's tough to qualify a fighter when there's so many fighters being pitched to you. So one thing I really looked at, you know, the main thing was I wanted to see video of the guy. I wanted to see what the guy could do in the cage and try to get an idea of how I could project him to the next level. But before I even spent time watching all his videos, I would go back and, you know, just go on SureDog and kind of cross-reference everything. The two things I would look for was finishing percentage. You know, how many fights have they won via finish in comparison to decision? And then I'd go back and you could look at all their opponents and kind of look at, you know, the combined record and combined winning percentage of the people that they had fought. And, you know, it's sometimes you would see stuff that looked pretty obvious and pretty transparent and you kind of knew the guy wasn't for real. But there were times even guys were built like that. They were given easy matchups and they were really strong talents. A guy that I will use an example, you know, because the UFC was not alone in signing fighters from that promotion. Bellator, as a matchmaker, I signed a fighter by the name of Ray Sloan, who had won fights for that organization, had some really easy matchups. But when I watched the video, when I spoke to people at Alliance MMA that had, you know, done some training with him and been around him, and I saw the video, I said, you know, irrespective of how he's been built, which, you know, I didn't really fundamentally agree with or like, this is a guy that's still a talent. This is a guy that I still think can be someone for Bellator, especially in the 205 division where there's a serious lack of depth. I said, you know, this is a guy that I think, even if he had been challenged at that level, probably still would have done well. And I signed Ray Sloan, and, you know, he came in and won his first fight for us, and I believe he won his second fight recently as well. So I think he's got his record at 9-0. So just because a guy has been fed some easy matchups and his record has been built doesn't mean he's not necessarily a good fighter and doesn't mean he doesn't have potential.
Right on. I guess you had mentioned, Pavel Wolak, and his boxing credentials obviously are, you know, something that's, very accessible. He's a pretty well-known guy. He's been training with, Team Henzo Gracie for a while. I'm sure you've had a chance to speak with, his trainers and stuff. You know, what are their statements on his overall MMA game outside of what, you know, obviously I'm sure he has, you know, phenomenal hands.
You know, I have not spoken to his head trainers. I haven't spoken to Henzo or Mark Henry specifically about Powell Wolak. The people that I've spoken to about Powell Wolak have been Monty Cox and Howard Horowitz, his managers, mm-hmm. as well as some of his training partners and guys that are affiliated with that camp, namely Jamal Patterson and Dante Rivera. And everyone has, you know, given me a glowing review of this guy. And they've talked about, you know, just, you know, how his hands are obvious, you know, how they're everything that you would expect them to be and how he's knocked a lot of guys out in training and just how he's going to be very dangerous with his hands in MMA. But the thing that they've told me is that his ground game is much further along than they ever imagined because, you know, with him having wrestled in high school, with him now working with Henzo and his top trainers on the ground, you know, they said that he's got a strong base, that he's not ready to fight top level ground guys yet, but that he's starting to make that transition. He has the right mindset and he has the right willingness to embrace the ground, whereas a lot of guys that have come over from boxing have really thought of themselves still predominantly as boxers and haven't really tried to reinvent themselves as mixed martial artists. And I think you look at Illinois, and it was the same concern that PA also raised, that, oh, well, boxers don't do well in MMA. They've never done well. And that's not true. The boxers that have come in and wanted to still be boxers in an MMA cage, those guys have gotten destroyed. But you look at boxers that have embraced MMA and reinvented themselves, like Powell Wolak is doing, and they've all done pretty well. You look at Holly Holm, who's a world champion boxer.
Yeah.
Look at Chris Lytle, Marcus Davis, Jeremy Williams, Rafael Butler recently lost for Bellator, but he has a good overall record. You look at all those people, they're boxers that became mixed martial artists, and you look at their combined record, they've done tremendously well.
Right on. The rest of, the card for Matrix Fights, I'm sure there'll probably be, you know, some additions in between now and then. What is the statement you'd like to give about, fighters in the Mid-Atlantic region looking to get on Matrix Fights and, maybe fight, for you guys?
You know, if you want to have fun, if you want to be on an exciting, event and, you know, the event that your friends and family are going to be excited to see, you know, you're not going to be the only fight that your friends and family are going to pay to see. There's going to be other fights on there if they do buy a ticket on your behalf that they're going to be excited to see. It's not like one of these events where, you know, you're going to buy a ticket or your friends and family are going to buy a ticket and they're going to want to get out of there right after you fight. There's a reason for them to independent of you, of the specific fighter, to come to the show and sit there from start to finish and watch all the fights. And, you know, a lot of the fighters that I've dropped tickets to off the last consignment tickets to the last couple of weeks, they've all said, hey, I'm really excited. The demand for this show has been tremendous. You guys have made it really easy for me to sell tickets to my friends and family. Thank you.
The Philadelphia MMA scene, you know, it's, think that, you know, with you guys especially, it's, you know, going to enter into a nice resurgence. But, you know, Eddie Alvarez is from Philadelphia. You know, did you get to see kind of the rise of his MMA career even before he joined Bellator?
Yeah, I've been a fan of his for years. It's hard to be a Philadelphian and you know, be interested in martial arts and not know the name Eddie Alvarez. And I remember a lot of his fights that he did in Atlantic City for a small organization called MFC. You know, he had a contract with Bodog. I remember going to Trenton, New Jersey, watching him fight, and there was a lot of issues with the ambulances. They didn't have enough ambulances, and guys were getting knocked out right and left. So after every fight, there'd be a 20 to 30 minute delay because the ambulance had to take someone to the hospital and then come back, and they had to wait for the ambulance to come back before they would start the show. And I remember being in that arena. They turned off the air conditioning in the dead of summer at midnight because that was the curfew, and Eddie's fight against Matt Lee on that show didn't happen until about 1:20, 1:30 in the morning. So, you know, it was a show that started at about 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock, and I remember staying there and watching that fight. So, you know, I've followed Eddie for years, so it was a tremendous honor to get the ability to work with him once I was able to get a spot with Bellator.
You know, I don't know where you stand when it comes to professional football, but I'm a New York Giants fan. It's where both me and you know, my family's from. You know, and I've been to games in Philly, and
you didn't tell me that before this interview. If I had known you were a Giants fan, I don't know if I would have done the interview. I'm just kidding.
But you know, it's definitely seen some interesting sights. You know, Philly fans are known for being very you know, passionate. You know, sometimes maybe a little over the top. You know, do you think the you know, that kind of mentality lends itself well to Philadelphia, you know, having become known as the fighting town that it is?
Well, I think you have to respect the passion and the knowledge of the Philadelphia fan base. It's just unfortunate that we have a small percentage of the Philadelphia sports fan population that takes their enthusiasm and their passion too far. And when they do step over the line, that usually gets broadcast to the media and really is casts a dark shadow over everyone here in Philadelphia that's a sports fan. But, you know, it just it's – you know, this town is a fight town because, yes, it's intense and it's aggressive. But for some reason, whatever it is, this town has always supported combat sports, whether it was boxing. This is a tremendous boxing town. So many world champions and so many amazing gyms and trainers come out of this city. Pro wrestling, you look at how this has always been a big market for pro wrestling, even before the days of ECW. You know, the NWA and WWF, now WWE, would always come here and run big shows and sometimes even run stadium shows. So, you know, even the martial arts, the traditional martial arts, maybe there haven't been big tournaments and big televised events, but when you talk about per capita, when it came to the amount of people training martial arts and the amount of traditional martial arts gyms that we have in this area, it's just so populated. There was always a ton of people training karate and judo and sambo and, you know, and Muay Thai and all the other traditional styles that we have now, even before we saw the fruition and the growth of Brazilian jiu-jitsu and MMA gyms. There's always been a lot of martial arts themed gyms here in the Philadelphia area, and almost on every corner where you go.
You know, there's you know, we talked about Eddie Alvarez. You know, Jesus Martinez is fighting in the main event for Matrix Fights. You know, do you care to comment on, you know, what are the, you know, kind of next crop of, you know, like big up-and-coming fighters from the Philadelphia area?
There's, you know, just so many guys, and, you know, it's hard to talk about just Philadelphia, you know, separated out. You have to look at the East Coast right now. You have to look at the New Jersey area. You have to look at the New York area. There's just so many guys coming up from Weidman's gym, and, you know, you have Henzo's gym in New Jersey and Dante Rivera's gym and Kurt Pellegrino's and AMA. You have Balance Studios here in Philly, Data's Fight Camps. There's just so many strong gyms. I think a guy that you're probably, you know, that I could point to from this area, and I'm not sure if he's a native Philadelphian, but I know he trains here at Daniel Gracie's gym here in Philadelphia in Northern Liberties, I think, or I guess maybe it's Fishtown, I'm not sure. But I think a guy that you're going to see fight in the UFC very soon, the next guy you're going to see make that step, and he's not on a Matrix show, but his name's Jonathan Webb. He's actually going to fight on pay-per-view for Cage Fury next weekend. And he's a guy that's undefeated, has a great wrestling background, and he's fighting a tough guy in Lyman Good in the main event of that show. If Jonathan Webb gets that win over Lyman Good, if he can beat a guy like that, you've got to think that Joe Silva and Dana White and the UFC are going to come calling and sign him in short order. Jonathan Webb is a training partner with Paul Felder, and Paul Felder just recently fought in the UFC, so I could definitely see Daniel Gracie sending another guy from his gym to the UFC, and I think it's going to be that guy. I think it's going to be Jonathan Webb. Whether it's sooner rather than later, that remains to be seen. I think the outcome of next week's show for Cage Fury, I think that's going to be a big telling factor.
You know, Cage Fury Fighting Championships, you know, they're really one of the great regional mixed martial arts promotions around here. They're starting to really develop a trend that, you know, first Ring of Combat really started, and just kind of being a great springboard for guys who can win there and then get into the UFC. You've been around since, I'm sure the earliest days of CFFC. What are your thoughts on their rise to where they're at now, and some of the things they're looking at on the horizon?
Well, they've done a lot of shows here in this area, and they've done a good job of getting casino deals and signing a lot of prospects and getting them to sign multi-fight deals, because they had the ability to offer them, they're running so many shows, they have the ability to keep those guys, busy and, give them a platform to fight on the next level. And they're starting to send guys to that next level, and I think that's great. But Ring of Combat has also been doing it for years. Matrix has been doing it now for a couple of years. We've sent a lot of guys to those big shows. So it's great for the fighters in the New York, New Jersey, and Philadelphia areas to have multiple options, to have multiple platforms, multiple stages where they can go and show their talent and take that talent and display it and possibly get a bigger deal with a Bellator or a UFC.
Right on. This will be my last major question, but I've heard you talk about it on your podcast, which what I said before, it's I love listening to the MMA Insiders podcast. I think it's definitely the most intelligently presented podcast on the subject of mixed martial arts. I've been looking forward to it every week since you guys have started it.
I appreciate that.
But you identified while you're still with Bellator, two, prospects, one, who still lives in Britain, the other who lives here, by the name of, Liam McGeary and also Michael Venom Page. They've come into Bellator and have really, done well. I'd like to get your thoughts on, how you discovered, both of those guys and, what you think about, their progress that's been made since they've come over to Bellator and, continued their careers there.
Well, with Liam McGeary, I go to a lot of smaller shows. Even when I was at Bellator, I'd go to smaller shows when I had the time, and but just go to see, who were the next up and coming guys from this area that I could maybe take to a show like Bellator and put them on a bigger stage. And I was at this small show in New Jersey, and Kurt Pellegrino, who I've been able to become friendly with over the last couple of years, came up to me and said hello and said, "Hey, man, I've got to introduce you to this guy. I've got this guy. You're not going to believe it. He's 6'5". He fights at 205. He's undefeated. He's from the UK. He's got a mohawk. You're going to love him. Let me go get him." And he brought me over. He brought him over to me, and I met Liam for the first time, and I just was staring straight up into the sky, and I'm like, "Wow, dude, how do you make 205?" And I looked at him and said, "You've got a pretty unique look." And I basically told Kurt, I'm like, "I don't even care if this guy can fight. He fights at 205 and he's huge. I need 205s desperately. I'm dying to get, young talent at 205. So I pretty much almost signed him there on the spot. It took maybe a couple of weeks for us to get a contract ironed out. And, I kind of did my back research. I'd already committed to signing Liam before I even really taking a look at his record and watched some video, but everything that I saw and everyone I spoke to, it backed up Kurt's assessment. And, really Kurt's, having a guy like Kurt Pellegrino vouch for somebody like Liam, that was enough for me. Just hearing Kurt talk about him, telling me that, I need to go out and sign this guy, was enough. And that, it was a tremendous endorsement in my book, but even just, following up on that and looking more into his background, I became even more and more impressed and realized very early on, pretty much before he even fought, that we had really found a diamond in the rough. And we really had beaten a lot of the bigger organizations to the punch when it came to the next big thing at 205. With Michael Page, in regards to him, that was just basically someone sending me a link saying, "Man, you've got to see this guy." And watching his fights on YouTube, just seeing the way he fought was so dynamic and so explosive and so unique. And I talked about it at the start of the show. This sport needs as many unique athletes to start to migrate into MMA in order for this sport to grow and get to the next level. And Michael Page was exactly the kind of guy that I was looking for. He's the exact kind of guy that I want to work with. And when I saw him, I did my research, found out where he was training, who was managing him, and I reached out to his manager, and I very aggressively tried to get him signed. And I was very fortunate that Bellator was able to bring him here to the U.S., and I was able to sign him. And, I just love watching that guy fight. His last fight maybe wasn't the most exciting, but, I think Nishan Burrell was trying to do everything he could to close the separation to try to prevent a knockout. But I think as you see Michael Page progress and develop his all-around game, I think you're going to see a guy that, you know, maybe will not be the champion that Anderson Silva was, but I think he will be the attraction and the type of entertaining fighter that you'll see that Anderson Silva is, where people just stop what they're doing, they pay whatever they have to, and they make an appointment television to tune in and watch the guy.
Yeah, you know, his latest fight, you know, against Sean Burrell, who, you know, I think was definitely the, you know, the toughest.
Another Matrix alum, by the way. He fought for us as an amateur, so.
Right on. You know, I think that was definitely his toughest test to date, but his fights previously abroad and then, you know, coming to Bellator, he, you know, with his striking style and just how he's able to finish fights, he made it look almost effortless. You know, I think he's definitely going to be a guy going forward for Bellator who can move the needle for sure. You know, kind of on that note, as far as prospects go, you know, I figured I'd maybe, if you haven't seen anything on him already, I'd, you know, maybe give you a tip. There's this guy down here in Richmond. It's one of my buddies, actually. His name is Dewan Dirty South Owens.
Yep, and, I know who that is, yes. We actually tried to get him on Matrix.
Right on, yeah. You know, he's on a pretty good streak right now. He's actually over in Russia. He's fighting again on November 1st and stuff like that. But I'd look forward to maybe seeing him fight for you guys at some point in the near future, man.
Yeah, I think we almost got him on this show, and I think that's definitely someone you'll see on a Matrix fight show probably in 2015.
Right on, man. Well, anyways, man, it was, you know, again, man, it was great talking to you. You know, man, it's, you know, this interview kind of really surpassed what my expectations were. I mean, I shouldn't have ultimately been surprised given, you know, the quality of your podcast and stuff. But, you know, I'd love to have you back on here anytime, man.
Anytime, David. I just want to remind everyone, Matrix Fights 9, we're coming back. Matrix is back December 5th. At the PA National Guard Armory, headlined by Jesus Chavo Martinez versus LeVon Maynard, two Bellator veterans. They're headlining the show. We've also got Will Martinez, still under contract to Bellator, and then the pro MMA debut of former boxing champion Paul Wolak, and much, much more. All that on December 5th. You can go to matrixtickets.com and order your tickets online today. You can also go to Dadas Fight Camps, UFC Gym in Springfield, Pennsylvania, and also Martinez BJJ in Northeast Philadelphia, and buy tickets directly from the fighters. Those are some sales stations for us. You can go there and go to our sales centers there and buy tickets from the fighters, or you can go online, like I said, matrixfights.com, or just go to matrixtickets.com, and that'll take you right to the credit card prompt page, and just order tickets right there.
Right on, man. Well, I guess I'll you know, stop recording. I just had one more question for you once we get off here, but thanks again for your time, man.
No problem. Thank you, David.